Supreme Lord, Eternal Truth, let us obey Thee alone and live according to truth. परमोच प्रभु सत्यम नित्यतमेव केवलम अनुवर्तामहे सत्यम अनुजीवम केवलम ओम शांति शांति शांति। नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग, वंदे मातरम, वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू। द टॉपिक ऑफ दिस मॉर्निंग स्पिरिचुअल डिस्कशन विल बी ऑन मदर। द टॉपिक इज आई एम ए डेप्यूटी ऑफ द एस्पायरिंग वर्ल्ड। द डायरेक्ट Mother of the direct voice of the Divine Mother, we are going to quote from Sri Aurobindo Savitri. I am a deputy of the aspiring world. This is the topic of discussion today. It is the firm voice, as voiced by the Divine Mother. It is told to the Lord of Death. So this is a great line. It is from Savitri. So we will discuss it in brief, of course. I am a deputy of the aspiring world, my spirit's liberty I ask for all. This is a great topic, it will be discussed in brief today. This is the spiritual discussion today for this morning. So Mother quotes initially, the soul is the figure of the unmanifest. Very interesting description as described by the Mother. The soul, we know the soul is inside us, it is a soul. So soul is, what is the definition, what really soul is meant, Mother quotes here. The soul is the figure of the unmanifest. The figure of the unmanifest, because it is yet to manifest, the figure of the unmanifest is the soul. When the soul is the figure of the unmanifest, then what about the other beings, mind, life and body? Here the quotes in the language voice of the Mother, Mother quotes here, Mother tried to explain. The mind labors to think the unthinkable. Initially, the soul is the figure of the unmanifest. The term used for the divine is unmanifest, yet to manifest, yet to be manifested. The mind labors to think the unthinkable. There is a labor in the mind with the mind to think the unthinkable. Unthinkable, it can't be thought of. So the mind labors, there is a labor in the mind to think the unthinkable. Third, the life, what is the about life? The call the immortal into bliss. Initially it was unmanifest, then second it was unthinkable, and third is immortal. Unmanifest is linked with the soul, figure of the unmanifest. And so unthinkable mind labors to think the unthinkable, the life to call the immortal into birth. So the body, whatever the body, body to enshrine the illimitable, beautiful term, mind, life, body and the soul. They are actually in the other term when in sequence, soul, mind, life and body. On the other side, it is there, the representing terms are unmanifest, unthinkable, immortal and illimitable. Very interesting really. And it is the term, everyone should at least understand the basics. Without the basics, very difficult to grasp the things, to understand the things, and simply we are using the terms and all. Mother quotes, Sri Aurobindo very brightly defines. I will quote it again. The soul is a figure of the unmanifest. The mind labors to think the unthinkable. The life to call the immortal into birth. The body to enshrine the illimitable. This world, the world is not cut off from truth and God. Again. About the world, entire world, Sri Aurobindo quotes here. The world is not cut off from truth and God. It is there, well linked with the truth, capital T and capital G, truth and God. Then Mother explains, actually answers the temptation of the Lord. Initially, Lord of Death has attempted to give some boons so that to soothe her wounds, to solace, to console. Like she feel, the Lord of Death feels that Mother is an ordinary human, just a normal human being. So that if some boons will be offered to her, she will be mooded and she will leave her Satyavan and flee away. Then that also Mother clarifies, Mother actually explains. Once more wilt thou call light to blind thy eyes. This is the very interesting comment by Mother. Once more wilt thou call light to blind the truth's eyes. Make knowledge a catch of the snare of ignorance and the award. a dart to slay my living soul. Soul, my living soul. Then, of course, Mother clarifies about the boon that is offered by Lord of Death to her to solace, to wound the hearts. Offer, O King, thy boons to tired spirits. Thy boons you go and offer, as you are offering, you would, of course you don't offer, that is the very, you are very much adamant, very much egoistic. You go and offer your boons to her, to the tired spirits and hearts, tired spirits and hearts that could not bear the wounds of time. The wounds of time and the most terrible wound, that the deepest wound is that the death of the very kith and kin, her husband, of course. So to the body and the mind, and let those who are tied to body and mind, people, you go, your boons are great, you go and offer your boons to those who are tied to body and mind, who can't bear the wounds of time, under the those who are actually have the tired spirits. Tear up those bonds and flee into white calm, crying for a refuge from the play of God, you go. Surely thy, still then, mother, smilingly, thy boons are great, surely thy boons are great, because thou art he. Still, not actually throwing it like anything. So there is also a, still there is a very cheerful voice, and smilingly mother speaks, surely thy boons are great, since thou art he. But how shall I seek rest in endless time, who house the mighty mother's violent force? Mother has compared between her and, of course, her, herself and between the Lord of Death. See, not that is that adamantine is there, not that ego is there. Mother simply clarifies who thou art and who art mine. Because you are offering the boons, boons can be offered to the tired hearts, tired spirits, people who are who can't bear the wounds of time, who are tied to their body and mind. But thing is that you know who you are and who thou art and who I am really. So, and of course, what the boons you are offering, they are great because this is offered by a great man, great soul, great God like you, because thou art he, capital H. But how shall I seek rest in endless peace, who house the mighty mother's violent force? I have housed the mighty mother's violent force, so how shall I rest content in the endless peace? Her vision turned to read the enigmatic world. So her will is tempered with the blaze of wisdom's sun and the flaming silence of the heart of love. This is with me, and how shall is interesting. So how shall I bear? How shall I live contented? How shall I be satisfied with the smallness? Then very interesting observation, and it is observed by mother. The world is a spiritual paradox, mother quotes. This world where we are dwelling is a spiritual paradox, and it is a spiritual paradox invented by a need in the unseen. This why this about this world, body, mind, life, and then your boons, who art thou, who art me, and about my needs, and about my confines, and about my magnanimity. Then here in the quotes, in the mother quotes, the world is a spiritual paradox invented by a need in the unseen. Invented by a need in the unseen, this world, that is a spiritual paradox. A poor translation to the creature's sense of that which is forever exceeds idea and speech. Poor translation of the creature's sense of that which forever exceeds idea and speech. It is there something. If this idea, beyond idea and speech, still then, you know, this paradox can be, is yet to be, the paradox yet to be solved, yet to be actually cleared out. A symbol of what can never be symbolized. This is the paradox. This can't be symbolized. This is a spirit, a symbol of what it can never be spiritualized. The a language mispronounced, misspelled, yet true. Its powers have come from the eternal heights and plunged into the inconscient dim abyss and arisen from it to do their marvelous work. So this is the thing, really truth is there. Then after some times, after a few lines here in the mother quotes here, in vain but thou hast dug the dark unbridgeable gulf. The gulf, it is there. And of course the eye of mother has come to bridge this unbridgeable gulf. It is the golden bridge, the wonderful fire. In vain thou hast dug the dark unbridgeable gulf. In vain thou hast built the blind and the doorless walls. These are not required in vain. All are in vain. You have done, you have built the wall, you have done, dug the hole. Man's soul crosses through thee through paradise. Thou hast got the need. People need it. Man need it. You have the got the, your presence is required because man's soul crosses through thee to paradise. Heaven's sun forces its way through death and the night. These are the requirements. For that thou hast been made by me. Of course, this made by me, it is called, it is explained towards the end of the chapter, really. Heaven's suns, initially, man's soul crosses through day to paradise. Heaven's sun forces its way through death and night. Its light is seen upon our being's birds. My mind is yet, then mother quotes about her own reactor, own characteristic, own greatness, and what really she is. My mind is a torch lit from the eternal sun. My life, a breath drawn by the immortal guest. My immortal body is the eternal's house. Just imagine who the mother is. Of course, we are capable of measuring the depth of the mother's greatness, who mother is, in her own language, in her own words. My mind is a torch lit from the eternal sun. My life, a breath drawn by the immortal guest. My mortal body is the eternal's house. Already the torch becomes the undying ray. That torch, it is as good, it was in, of course a torch, but it is now, it has turned the undying torch becomes the undying ray. Already the life is the immortal force. That how the house grows of the householder part and one. So it was there, my mind was like a torch from the eternal sun. This light, what happens is it becomes the undying ray. Then second, my life is a breath drawn by the immortal guest. Already the life is the immortal force. This has been the change, this has been the transformation. So the house grows of the householder part and one. How sayest thou truth can never light the human mind? So if it is there possible with me, and I am with me, this is my identity, this is my characteristic I have brought out. Then how shall you claim that, how sayest thou that a truth can never light the human mind and bliss can never invade the mortal's heart or God descend into the world he made? This is the truth. Truth that is actually ever bearing ever enlightened truth, but thou hast not known. And mother quotes here, if in the meaningless void creation rose, if from a bodiless force matter was born, if life could climb unconscious tree, if green delight its green delight breaks into emerald leaves, and its laughter of beauty blossom in the flower, if sense could wake in tissue, nerve and cell, then and thought sees the grey matter of the brain, and soul peep into the secrecy through the place. How shall the nameless light not leap on men, and unknown powers emerge from nature's sleep? If these are the things it is done, and it is ever done, it is possible. Then how it is not possible that nameless light not leap on the earth? The unknown powers emerge from nature's sleep. So, mother, again quotes, I live in the glory of the infinity. Very interesting observation. The mother has quoted. Our real identity, it is identified, it is acted, spoken by mother. I am not bound by thought or sense or say. I live in the glory of the infinity. I am near to the nameless and unknowable. The ineffable is now my household made. But standing on eternity's luminous brink, I have discovered that the world was he, the Lord. I have made spirit with spirit, self with self, but how I have also loved to the body of the God. Then a very interesting observation by the mother, it is quoted. I have pursued in him his earthly form, a lonely freedom can't satisfy. I am the deputy of the aspiring world.